Wait, you have a TV?
No, I just like to read the TV guide. Read the TV guide. You don't need a TV.
Hello, everybody. It's Wednesday. I am Ken Reed, as I am every Wednesday. And frankly, to be honest with you, I'm Ken Reed all 7 days out of the week, most days in the month, and almost every month of the year. And it is time for a brand new edition of TV Guidance Counselor, as it is each and every Wednesday. Today is a very, very fun episode. I was lucky enough to grab some time from the fantastic comedian, filmmaker, and author Negin Farsad. Negin was named one of Comedy Central's comics to watch. She has a book out currently called How to Make White People Laugh, has a great podcast of her own, and has directed several films. You will most certainly be checking out her stuff if you are unfamiliar with her work. If you are listening to the show because you are familiar with her work and you are unfamiliar with this show, I'm not judging you. Welcome to the show. As I said, my name is Ken Reed, and this show is the show where we talk about the classic television choices we made growing up using TV guides as our entry into the nostalgic memories of our sometimes tumultuous youth. And that's no exception this week. Negin picked a very fun issue of TV Guide, and we talked about what she watched growing up. We were sitting in Harvard Yard because she was here doing a book event. So there's some nice little atmosphere, some collegiate atmosphere here. I don't think you can get college credit for the episode, but you are welcome to try. And if it works, please let me know that it does. I would like to get a master's degree. And I think the body of work here on the podcast, if that is acceptable, would be more than enough to get so. So please sit back, relax, and enjoy today's episode of TV Guidance Counselor with my guest, Negin Farsad.
TV is my friend, and it has been always there for me in time of need.
Negin, how are you?
I'm good.
Thank you so much for doing this.
Thank you so much for having me.
You're very welcome. We are sitting outside here at Harvard.
Yeah. This is my first outdoor podcast.
Is it? I've done a few outside. It seems weird.
Yeah, but I hope that the readers feel a little something. I mean, readers.
Yeah. Well, what I do is that I record it as a podcast, but then I transcribe
it.
Yeah, and people have to purchase the transcription. I wonder if anyone did. Do you remember shows when we were growing up would always offer a transcription, like especially talk shows?
I never did. Did you? I always thought that that was a, like for researchers or something, like a very weird special message that was only there for research
but
people.
I'm like, who is researching like Donahue? Because it would always be like, for a transcript of this Sally Jesse Raphael, send, you know, it's like $39 to this thing. I wonder, it'd be funny if someone's like government campaign was about all the job losses for the people who used to transcribe television shows that no longer do that.
Court stenographers would do it as a side gig.
They could. You know, I learned a weird thing about them. They all have their own language. So only the stenographer who wrote the notes can read those notes.
Oh, Jesus.
Which is super weird.
That's really weird. How does that help the law?
I guess it's just like built-in job security, or they're like, we need, you know, and not anyone can look at it, or because they all have that weird shorthand because there's eight keys.
Right.
But I just found that I had no idea that that's what they did.
I didn't even know that there was eight keys. I thought they were just speed typers.
I did too, but then I looked at jury duty once, and I was like mostly interested in just looking at the stenographer thing because you never see those
that's
up close.
That's what you got out of jury duty.
Yeah.
Not like your American duty to uphold the judiciary branch of the United States.
My wife is not a U.S. citizen. She's British, and she loves being able to turn down jury duty every time she gets called for it. I'm sorry, I'm not a U.S. citizen.
That's the one reason you would stop from becoming a U.S. citizen.
Just to not do jury duty?
That and like a deep and unabiding hatred for the United States.
That's true. Or just like to not have to pay the taxes.
Oh, yeah.
They did
pass. Yep.
The very weird thing about U.S. taxes, well, there's a lot of weird things about U.S. taxes.
Tell me about it.
But when I lived in the U.K., the U.S. is the only country.
That's, by the way, a country name brag right
yes,
there.
Yes, it is. Did like, I drop the name of the country, the UK? I don't know if you know the UK.
I lived there for a while.
It's kind of
so
like
no
DKNY, but like as a country.
met a lady there. It's fine. Let's not even talk about it.
Some things happened. It's the old country is what I call it. But the U.S. is the only country where you pay taxes based on citizenship and not residency. So
yeah.
Even if you're in another country living, you still have to pay the U.S. taxes.
You still have to pay U.S. taxes,
which
yeah.
is crazy.
I've lived in other countries for short stints, but I was earning nothing.
Nothing.
So, I,
yeah.
you know, I was earning, like, enough to not have to tell anyone about it.
What countries have you lived in?
I lived in Paris.
Oh, very nice. Which is a
that
city.
Is a city brag.
Yes. Did you go to school there? Or were you working?
I lived there probably all told a year and a half. And I did a like a 6 month semester there,
yeah.
and then I did a summer there, and then I did another like I got a work visa
yep.
and
BUNAC?
A what?
Was it BUNAC?
The work visa?
Yeah, yeah.
Was that what it's called? Like, was that a thing that it?
It was like a weird program they had. I think we're roughly the same age. They ended it.
Yeah.
In the early 2000s because the U.S. was kicked out of the BUNAC program.
Oh, I don't remember the name of the thing I was in, but that's sad that the U.S. was kicked out of there.
Yeah.
Because I had a wonderful time. I mean, I waitressed. I taught English. I was a barista, and I was an American barista
nice.
In London.
Oh.
So I lived in London for a while.
Where in London?
I lived in Hampstead.
Oh, nice.
And,
nice. Home of the Heath.
Finsbury.
Finsbury Park.
Finsbury Park.
Yes.
And they wanted to have legitimate American baristas.
Right.
And I had barista experience.
Right. Which here people would be like, ugh.
Yeah.
No,
but it was like really, they thought I was the coolest.
Yeah.
And they like were like, take over the reins of this entire coffee
right.
company. Like, you know what
Train
you're doing.
Us with your American ways.
And I was like, I really don't. Can I just, because I got to go get drunk later.
Yeah. I'll show you how to use this. This is called Mr. Coffee. You press brew and then you walk away. You walk
no,
away.
No, but you know, I was really proud of my ability to like you know make a heart on the you know
oh,
on
you
the
did
cappuccino
the
and all that stuff like I was you know I'm a nerd so everything I do I'm like no I gotta excel
right.
at it you know so I actually in that and if we're completely 100% honest that is the job I miss the most is being a barista.
Being a barista?
Yeah.
Just because it was satisfying?
There's something like someone asked for a coffee and you give it to them and they're happy and they want it done a certain way and it's done that certain, it's customized.
Right.
And they're happy if you do it well. And then they're, you know, they're real dicks if
right.
you don't do it well. But so there's something about that that's like instant gratification. But also like, I don't know, I like people. I like it just like, you know, like a 6 hour shift would go by so quickly.
Cause you're interacting and it's like a low stakes skill set.
Yeah. And I don't know. I just had an enormous amount of fun.
It's nice to be able to make a thing. Like, especially if you do
exactly.
stand up where you kind of do it and it's gone.
Yeah.
Which must've been satisfying writing a book. Cause you're like, oh, this is a thing.
This is a
I
thing.
Have.
It is a physical, right.
yeah.
And thank you for mentioning my book,
oh, you're
How to Make, How to
yes.
Make White People Laugh,
yes.
Available now wherever fine books are sold.
But that would make sense that you,
but,
you know, would enjoy
although
having like,
I
a
think
physical.
What I've learned about myself is that I'm in a field that's really, really laptop dependent. Like I have
yes.
to be on a computer a lot to generate the material, to generate the scripts, to generate the books, whatever it is, the books I say as
yeah,
if I've written
all 40
really
of
just
them.
One, just
volume
one.
Volume 1, yes.
But I think maybe, and I think a lot of Americans feel this way, I don't like being on a computer
it's
as
like
much.
Dehumanizing, or just you want to interact?
I just want to be around more people. I want to be on my feet. I want
right.
to till soil. I'll till soil.
Yeah.
I don't give a fuck. I'll
yeah.
till some soil.
You'll sow some seeds.
Yeah. And so I think there's just something that's very, yeah, it's like alienating.
There is. I mean, as much as I hated waiting tables when I was in college and stuff, which
yeah,
I always
waited tables.
I always joke that was what made me do well in school. So I was like, I never want to do this
yeah,
again.
Yeah.
But at the same time, like you'd get home and you'd be physically tired and be like,
great.
You'd sleep
you'd
well.
Sleep really well.
Yeah. Yeah.
You know, when you got tips and you would count your tips and you would be like, yeah,
I did
I'm
it.
Awesome.
Instant gratification.
Yeah. It felt good. I mean, I remember when I was waiting tables and I was a barista kind of like, would bounce back and forth between those two jobs, I felt like I can see how people, and I would meet some people that were kind of career waiters.
Right.
And I was sort of like, I can see how that happens.
Oh, yeah, totally.
Like, easily see how that happens
yeah.
because the money, depending on where you are, isn't horrible.
Yeah.
And, yeah, and you can just sort of, like, be really good at it. It's multitasking. It
it's
takes
social.
A lot of hand-eye coordination. It's
yeah.
social. It's like, you know, you're constantly strategizing. It's sort of like an elaborate... Or like a micro but elaborate game theory, you
yeah,
know?
It's controlled chaos, essentially.
Completely.
Yeah.
So you have to keep a lot of things in line in order to make it work well. And so if you can do it well, it's sort of like, yeah, this is a great skill.
Were you watching TV when you were in other countries?
I watched I did. I would watch. I mean, the sad thing about France, they have laws that say, like, you can't have more than this percentage of
French content.
Yeah. So, but even, but despite the laws, I felt like there was just a ton of American shows.
It's weird what they
export. And they would be, like, 5 years behind or something. And so I would watch something on French television that seemed very old to me.
Would it be, it wouldn't be comedies generally because those don't translate that well.
Like, I remember watching Friends in France.
Well, Friends was huge. I was going to bring that up for the UK because I don't know when you lived there, but when I did, Friends was the biggest thing ever. So it makes sense that they're like baristas in coffee shops.
Yeah, yeah, no,
it's
exactly,
just like Friends.
Exactly. But yeah, Friends was a big one. I'm trying, but I think by and large, when I lived in both of those countries, I didn't, and I had a brief stint in India for like 2 months.
Mm-hmm.
I just ended up sort of feeling like the television made me feel like I wasn't in another country, and so I didn't, and I just wouldn't end up watching it.
So a lot of people would watch it for that reason, as like a taste of home, like a comfort
thing.
But
no,
you didn't want the reminder that you were. That,
I liked being in this weird. I wanted to feel like I'm in it. I'm in this other country,
right.
And also, you know, like in terms of like having cable and stuff like that. A lot of those countries are well behind. Like it was,
oh, yeah.
They had very few channels up until very recently.
Mm-hmm.
They had very few channels. We've had hundreds of channels for a very long time.
Yeah.
And so that was something that was kind of, different about, being in those countries. So it's not like, you know, if you turned it on, there wasn't very many options, you know?
Yeah.
So it was just kind of like, what's the point?
I mean, I remember when I was in the UK, the stations had sign-offs. They would sign off
really?
At a certain hour. We hadn't had that since, like, 1978. Like,
we
and this was, like,
right?
2002, and they're like, good night for the evening. And I'm like, well, you can't do that.
Did they then display an American flag? Isn't that what
would,
we used
yes,
to do?
Yes, they would play the national anthem. They would, yeah, that was the weirdest thing. It was, like, television, when it first came on, was such a nationalistic thing.
Yeah,
it was
very
like a,
patriotic.
Yes, we've, technology is American.
Yeah,
so people
it was, like,
would,
a part of, like, wars and
yeah.
stuff. Like, it was like they're doing its patriotic duty.
People would dress up to watch it and then salute America when it signed off, being like, good job,
that
America.
That sounds made up.
Seems to be the case.
All right.
It was like,
we're here with historian Ken.
I am a noted historian, which is why we're at Harvard. Well, you can watch a lot of those sign-offs on YouTube now, and a lot of them, they are oddly patriotic.
That's funny.
And it's just like the station's shut. It's like a store closing for the day.
One of the things on television that I was glad to see still sort of existed was the Yule Log at
yes.
the holidays. It exists on demand.
Yes. Yeah.
Because I remember, like, you know, as a kid, that a channel would just be a Yule Log or something. I don't remember
yeah.
exactly what the.
You grew up in Palm Springs?
I grew up in Palm Springs, California.
Okay.
And so, yeah, I remember like just an entire channel being the Yule Log and feeling like, and then at some point being like, we don't have that anymore, do we?
Yeah.
You know? And then I was flipping through the channels over the holidays and I saw
that
on demand.
Went away for a long time. And now
yeah.
all that's coming back. Like reruns weren't on for a long time. And now you have stations like Antenna, MeTV. So it's interesting to see how like the cycle.
'Cause, you know, right now. You know, I spent a lot of time in hotel rooms.
Yep.
I was in a hotel room here in Boston, in fact, last night.
Confession time.
And, hey,
bird fight.
These birds are
yep.
really
they are they're territorial.
Having a thing right now.
Even the birds in Boston get in fights.
Oh, my God. They're naked and they're fighting.
Yeah, one of them just asked another one what it was looking at and is really fighting.
So this is so funny. I love this sound. I was like flipping through the TV in Boston and which is a lot like the TV in New York, I'll have you know.
Right.
And in one of the things that I find every time I'm in a hotel room is just like there are so many sports channels
oh, yeah.
out of control and then so many news channels
yeah.
out of control. And they're all saying the same thing. So it was really we would only need one, maybe two, or like one and
yeah.
a half news channels would really kind of do the job. But anyways, we have like multiple. And then we have multiple other channels that all have reality programming, which for me, and no offense to all the reality lovers out there, it's almost like I'm looking at a blank screen and
yeah,
I just click.
What's the point?
I just
yeah.
do not look at it.
Yeah.
It has to be narrative or bust.
Right.
And so that's one of the things I think, you know, because I look back at one of the things I really used to love during like Christmas holidays and summer holidays and stuff like that when I was a kid was like sort of flipping through the channels and I always found something.
Oh yeah.
And now I feel like when I'm flipping the channel it's much harder to find something because the, you know, the first 45 options are reality TV. Yeah. And then there'll be one, you know, a rerun of like
Law and Order.
Law and Order. And then there'll be, you know, maybe You've Got Mail. And then you're like, okay, I'll do that again, you know, or something like that. And it used to be there were like 10, you know, like Virgin, you know, You've Got Mail type options. Right. And like, it's just not like that anymore.
I think as we moved away from true broadcasting, where the stations were like, we want a little bit of something for everyone, which made it more likely you'd see something interesting, to this narrow casting where they're specializing. And I remember,
but it feels like there's nothing for no one.
Yeah, it's that's what's happened. It's gone so far the other way. Like, I remember when the Golf Channel started, people were like, are you kidding me? We have a whole Golf Channel. And I'm like, we've grown into a world where it's all the Golf Channel.
Yeah, everything's a Golf Channel. And so I feel like I have nothing to watch.
Yeah, it's true.
And I, you know, and flipping through the channels was a pastime, and I don't feel like it's, you know.
Well, the prospect of something interesting coming on is sort of gone because you know what's, if the channel is just showing reality all day, that's what they're showing.
Right.
But sometimes you'd be like, it's a commercial. What's going to come on? I don't know. It might be something amazing.
Yeah.
You don't stumble on
also,
stuff as
I
much.
Also, I think, and I don't, and I'm talking out of my ass here, but I think that there's more commercials now because
there is.
Right. Like, I don't know what the numbers were, you know, in the 80s and 90s when I was growing up. There were commercials for sure. Use them as pee breaks. Mm-hmm. Loved them, you know?
Yeah.
And now it feels like they're so long.
They are. So like a 20, so say a half hour sitcom when we were growing up was 25 minutes.
Uh-huh.
It's 20 minutes now.
Right.
So there's a whole five more minutes
of
commercials.
Wow, they were 25 minutes.
25, yeah. They, around the transition, I think we're roughly the same age, maybe a little younger, but then they were 22 for a little while.
Yeah.
But they are 20 now and sometimes like 18 minutes.
It's really, really sad.
That's, can you imagine, like, as someone who, you know, writes stories, telling a story in 18 minutes, that's very difficult.
Nightmare.
With four breaks in the middle.
No, and it's funny, too, because I realized something after watching, an episode of Girls on HBO, that they're not even, those are not 30 minutes either.
No.
Like, because they do, like, 5 or 6 minutes of HBO promotion.
Mm-hmm.
Then they do, like, this is what happened last time. And then they do the show. And then at the end, there's another few minutes of HBO. You know what I mean?
Yeah, so they're even,
they're
like, 24
minutes. They're also doing,
like,
yeah, exactly. Yeah. So you're never actually getting, you know, a 30-minute anything.
Which is weird, too, because then they're doing all these weird things to sort of combat DVRs. So you'll see those, like, fake the show is back little spots. Oh, it's on! But then it's just, like,
God.
A 10-second interstitial.
So I watch Meet the Press on
Fair
Sundays.
Enough.
And, there's a couple of like political roundtable shows that I have a podcast launching in July on the Earwolf Network.
Very
and
nice.
It's called Fake the Nation.
Excellent.
Which is off of Face the Nation. Another one of my guilty like Sunday pleasures.
Did you watch
Sunday
that stuff growing
pleasures.
Up? Or is that like an adult thing?
I guess I was always really political.
So that you went to school for and stuff too, right?
Yeah. I grew up, you know, I remember when I was 11 years old, like I had a flash of genius and I marched into the living room where my parents were. And I was like, guys, get this. I'm going to be president of the United States. No big deal. Like I was just like, yeah, that's what I'm going to do. Isn't that a great idea? Isn't that great?
I don't know why I didn't think of this before.
And my parents were like, all right, that is fine. You know, and it's not. And honestly, there's nothing I did in my academic life that didn't actually fall in line with that, right? Because like college, I was a double major in government and theater, and then I went and got
which
two
are kind of the same thing now.
Same thing, right? Oh, so sad. And then I got two masters. I got a master's degree in African American studies, like most Iranian American Muslim ladies.
Yep, absolutely. You're on that path.
On that path, makes sense. And I doubled that up with a master's degree in public policy.
Right.
And I was a policy advisor for the city of New York before ever being a comedian. You know, when writing a book called How to Make White People Laugh, which is available wherever fine books are sold, like all that stuff was just a glint in my eye. I mean, I had been, but I was doing comedy the whole time.
Right.
Thinking like, this is just a hobby. I'm not going to be an idiot. I'm going to be an adult. I'm
going to
wear
poor.
Pantsuits. I don't want to be poor. I don't want to be, unstable. I want to rise through the ranks and then run for president.
Right, right. It could still happen.
And you know what? It really could still happen because literally the most insane thing is happening right now. I would be a far more reasonable candidate than Donald Trump.
There
and
are
I'm
no
Muslim.
More skeletons that people have a problem with. You know what's always weird to me about Obama when people are like, but you don't understand, he's a Muslim, which he's not. But also, if someone was like, okay, then what? Like, that's a big complaint.
Yeah,
all right, let's say that that's true, and then what is the issue there? I listen to a lot of right-wing radio, and I don't know why.
But does it make you grit your teeth?
Yes. I mean, part of it is I really like to argue, and so I like to know the dumb things.
Grit your teeth doesn't make any
sense. I grind
them,
too.
Okay,
I do grit them as well.
Okay,
there's a lot of gurring.
Oh, good.
And part of it, I think, is just it's almost like a zoo. Like, I'm just like, how do they act in their natural habitat when they don't think we're watching them?
Right, and it's just
the insane things.
Well, and so here's the weird thing. So now that I have this book out called How to Make White People Laugh, that like a lot, I keep saying it. I don't mean to be this. I'm not promoting. It's
this
just
will
that,
be
like,
plugged all over the website.
I'm just reminding that the name is considered offensive to some people,
is it really?
Which is hilarious to me because I'm like, guys, like some of my best friends are white. You know what I mean? Like, kinda,
people have literally been offended by that name.
Yeah, I got just a Bostonite. Someone in Boston, actually, I was on a Boston show yesterday, and they wrote on Twitter, like, why don't you come up with a less racist name, and then I'll think of reading your book.
Or I call it, like, honky talk. Something like that, you know?
Yeah. Crackers.
Yeah.
And so I think that it's, so there's something about the title that makes, like, the right wing talk radio shows want to have me on,
right?
You know, because they want to get into it.
They want to beat you up, basically. Is that the or
yeah?
You like
they want to catch me in something, and I was on a conservative talk radio show with a really lovely gentleman, actually, who's Mexican American and is 100% in favor of the wall,
right?
You know, Trump's wall, and 100% in favor of banning Muslims.
Right.
And, you know, but he was really nice. And
but only until we figure out what the hell's going on.
Yeah, just
you
temporary.
Need to say the whole
temporary,
thing.
Just temporary. And it was funny because I'm like, yeah, the Japanese internment camps were also temporary. It's cool.
That, to me, is one of the darkest days of American history that we did that. It's a huge black mark on America. And the people on the
following
radio,
the other actual darkest days of American history,
yes,
where we had slaves. Like, you think that we're like, hey, man, we got this slave thing really wrong.
We had internment camps in Japan, and
it was fine.
I was like, no, that was a bad thing. Yes, we did do that, but that doesn't mean that it was okay.
Someone said to me that, oh, my gosh, Star Trek guy.
George Takei.
George Takei.
He was in a camp.
Had said that they weren't, like, abusive or anything.
No, he didn't.
Someone said that, oh yeah, no, even
he
George Takei says that they weren't like bad places. And I was like, really?
Yeah.
But even if someone said they are not,
yeah,
that they weren't abusive or whatever, violent, that still doesn't make like imprisoning people in that way.
Oh, yeah. That's like someone who was sent to prison for a crime they didn't commit, being like, he said nobody raped him.
Right, exactly.
What's your problem? I'm like, no, it doesn't mean that it's okay. Yeah.
No, totally. Yeah. I've had a lot of these kinds of remarks thrown at me, especially, you know, and I think I'm like short of a target for that because my last movie was called The Muslims Are Coming, and you know, I took a bunch of Muslim American comedians on the road, and we went to places like Alabama, Mississippi, and Georgia, and whatever. We were trying to dispel Islamophobia and do the thing, and blah blah blah. And so a lot of people then too were just like, I was on Breitbart, I was on being attacked, like I wouldn't go on Breitbart.
Did they consider you like un-American
front page
or something?
And all of that stuff. Oh, well, they call me, look, I was called, constantly, when that movie first came out in 2013, 2014, I was called an Islamo-fascist.
Right.
The entire time, and, every day, another outlet was calling me an Islamo-fascist, and I was like, I don't even know, what does that mean?
Right.
What am I trying to do? What is the thing I'm 5'4", and I dress like a cartoon character, so what exactly am I?
Do you know what fascist means? It's different from fashion, you know that, right? Like, I know this is a nice dress, but that's not what I'm talking about.
And I'm like, I don't even have a standing army. I don't know.
Yeah.
You
yeah.
know, it, you need a lot more to do the fascism. So I feel like I've been on the talk And what I try and do at every turn is just like keep it real delightful. I don't want to get into an argument that just doesn't. It's just not helpful, you know. And
then you're playing the part that they've sort of cast you as, yeah, to have you on that stuff.
Yeah.
Do you feel like are your parents from Iran?
Yeah. They immigrated before I was born.
Okay, so you were born in the United States.
Yeah.
And do you feel like you are missing out on some sort of cultural thing with that? Because you're American or American.
Yeah,
and
yeah.
Do people like in your home country of Iran, I imagine they would do a lot of that kind of thing when they would talk to you in the South or things like that.
You know what's interesting? Well, first of all, I think people think that I would have any kind of real authority on what's going on in Iran. Yeah. I don't.
Right.
Palm Springs, California, though. Hey,
very different.
I'll talk about it.
Well, it's like people here in Boston who are basically Irish or Italian descent, they will tell you all about politics in Ireland and how it is in the old country.
Yeah,
I'm like, your great-grandfather had to leave because he was a drunk. So you live here now. You don't know anything about what's going on over there.
But it's interesting because, so that brings me to my other point, which is that I got a question recently in a couple of hate tweets and remarks or whatever about why do I call myself an Iranian American, and why I must be exploiting my background because
to get ahead because you're so well liked.
Yeah. I'm just exploitative about being an Iranian American, whatever. Yeah. And I was like, okay, first of all, and the thing about these things is like, what's really frustrating is I just want to walk around like with my resume stapled to my chest because, you know, my first feature film was called Nerdcore Rising. It was about nerds, like nerdy nerds. And no
from
one was like
Nerdania.
From the country of Nerdania.
Yeah.
And nobody was like, oh, she's exploiting nerd cult. Yeah. You know what I'm saying? Like, or you know, I've written for MTV and Nickelodeon but whatever. And I wrote jokes about Justin Bieber and, you know, Kim Kardashian. And that was my job.
That's xenophobic. He is from Canada.
True.
Yes.
And so nobody ever. So for A, I don't. It's not like my entire career is I talk about being Iranian American.
Right.
And B, and I have a movie coming out July 5th, Third Street Blackout. It's a rom-com set on the blackout after Hurricane Sandy.
Yeah.
And that's it. There's no nothing. I'm not.
Oh yeah.
There's no political. Whatever. So anyway. And that's another. I mean, these are significant works, and so I'm just sort of pissed that people like tweet these things out or whatever without like just really considering the person.
They're minimizing the other stuff.
But also, let's say you're a comedian who talks about. I know comedians.
I grew up in a big Italian family.
Yeah, I grew up in a big Italian family. And then are we pissed at that guy because he constantly talks about his big Italian family?
I am, but most people aren't.
No, I know a lot of Boston. There's certain parts of the country. I know a lot of Boston comics who will reference Boston constantly in their stand-up. And they won't even be living in Boston anymore.
Yeah.
And I'm not mad. I'm not mad. You know, I'm not like, oh, they're exploiting
using
their
Boston. Using that
sense
of identity.
Yeah. And like, hey, man, you live in New York City now. Like, can you drop this Boston thing?
Yeah.
Like, and why do I have to drop my entire identity?
It's a cultural.
It's literally my actual being.
Yeah.
My actual being is an Iranian-American Muslim lady. It's not a buzzword.
Right.
And it like that shit makes me mad. Oh, that I mean I just saw comments today, which is why I'm all riled up.
No,
I'm gonna
fair enough. I'm
gonna
sure you get
unrile
them
myself
often.
Up.
Yeah.
I do. I'm gonna unrile myself up though for the rest of this chat.
Well, one thing, you know, and we'll get into TV guide in a minute here, but one of the things that I always find very funny is that the people who I often hear complaining about people not assimilating live in Little Italy. Or, you know, they'll have no problem with Chinatown or anything like that. I'm like, if you're going to have a problem with that, man, like, be, you know, have a problem
totally,
with it. Like,
totally.
I went down to Little Tokyo. These people, they're living in paper houses. Like, no one ever complains about that. But they'll be, it's
that's
very.
So true.
Or they'll be like, oh, my grandmother made the best Italian gravy and the mozzarella. And meanwhile, someone's like, oh, it's Passover. And they're like, you need to assimilate. Very weird.
No, exactly. We just haven't gotten to that point where, you know, because now like Irish and Italian are just like American, you know, they're just
but it all is, you know,
whatever. And so it's cool. We just haven't gotten to that point with other ethnic groups yet. We will. Hopefully, and hopefully, you know, we'll still be alive.
Well, it's funny because we're seeing the same. Not to get too sociopolitical, but we're seeing the same patterns that we always saw,
completely.
Where the middle class now is just Hispanic and Black and not white anymore, and so. people don't like that, certain people. And it's like, no, that's what happened. You know, your working class sort of Irish Italians replaced the more blue blood, old money people. And just the same thing's happening. It just happens that the last group of immigrants was not from a white country.
Right.
You know, I don't know what their problem is. But when you were growing up, and I think you touch on this in the book, and you said you studied African-American studies, you kind of didn't have a cultural touchstone on television. So didn't you kind of gravitate or like wish that you could at least be Hispanic or black?
I really long to be black or Mexican. Yeah. Because in Southern, growing up, I was Mexican. I lived in Southern California, and there are a lot of Mexicans, and they had like all of the, you know, the cultural thing kind of down.
Yeah. Did people ever just assume you're Mexican?
Not really in Palms. We had so many like that everybody knew.
Right.
I think when I moved to New York is when people started confusing. Like they were like,
"Did
what
just speak
are
Spanish
you?
To you?"
Yeah, I lived in this part of Queens where there are a lot of Mexicans and a lot of Greeks. And so I would walk into a Mexican store, they started speaking to me in Spanish. I'd walk into a Greek store, they started speaking to me in Greek. Like there was just an assumption that I was like one of those things.
Right.
Because I think I'm because I'm sort of. Like I'm a thing, but nobody can figure out which thing.
Yeah, they're like dark hair, Greek.
Yeah. So, but in college, there were no Mexicans, and so there, you know, there was just like a handful. But the more visible minority group in college were the Black Americans,
right?
And that's kind of like where I started feeling like, ooh, what's this? You know. Because, like, when you're a part of, like, a really, like, underpopulated ethnic minority, you kind of glom onto whatever the larger ethnic minority is. And for me, it's like I knew the Black struggle wasn't my struggle.
Right. But it's
like, not
a struggle.
By a long shot. But it was a struggle, and it was a recognized, well-defined struggle.
Right.
And I was just like, you know, that'll do.
That's
Let's
close
do that.
Enough.
That's close enough.
Yeah.
And so,
especially in like the 90s, though, where, you know, we were getting a lot more Black culture and popular culture. We were getting, you know, Fox was kind of the Black network for a while before UPN and CW. So we were getting a lot more shows that were just about Black people and weren't the, although I love them, the Norman Lear shows that were like, they're poor and living Cabrini Green.
Right.
You know, it was more like, oh, it's living single. They're just having fun. Like that. But it's slightly different.
I remember feeling like, a different world was like speaking to me.
Yeah, I loved a different world. I was disappointed college was not like a different world.
Yeah, I know. No, totally, totally. I was looking for flip-up glasses like all over the place.
I think I'm going to apply at Hellman.
Did not, yeah. Oh my gosh. And you know, I really considered applying to like Howard and Spelman and some of those historically Black colleges. And didn't because I just started being obsessed with living in New York City.
Right.
But I really love that show. I feel like it kind of did so. And it's more than The Cosby Show. I feel like The Cosby Show was like a little bit removed from me and maybe because I'm not.
Well, I think it was removed from a lot of people because it was a very affluent family generally.
Yeah.
You know, I don't know if your family was not affluent, but I don't mean to imply that. But it was, you know, it's a doctor and a lawyer. Like, regardless of race, most people can't really quite identify with that kind of family dynamic.
And I think also that, like, there was a show, and I don't remember when this show, I want to say it was like the late 80s or something, and it was called 30-something.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. The first yuppie show.
And I remember, I was a kid, okay? Yeah. I was like 8 years old, and I was like, excuse me, Mom, Dad, I'm watching 30-something.
I watched it every week.
You wouldn't understand.
Yeah.
I really thought of myself as like some sort of little adult.
Sophisticated.
Yes. Yeah. And I didn't understand what was going
on. No, I watched it every week and I'm like, yeah, these yuppies in Pittsburgh, I need to know what they're. But then when the creators of that show went on to create My So-Called Life, it was perfect because I'm like, it's that tone, but for my age.
Yes, exactly. Exactly. And then My So-Called Life felt like the most important show, you know.
Absolutely.
So that's kind of where my, I think part of the Cosby Show that was never really appealing to me. And, you know, it's, every time I say his name now, I feel weird because like,
well,
you
we
know,
all should.
Self-recognized. Yeah. He is a dude that raped people, but
drugged and raped.
He drugged and raped. Sorry, didn't mean to promote him to just.
Hey, some
rape.
Of them said it wasn't that bad. George Takei said it wasn't that bad. Which is so because that show is a good show. It's a sweet show.
Yeah.
It's a funny show, and it's so awful that man being a monster ruins it. Because there was a lot of good people involved in the making of that show.
I wonder after some years. I mean, it's just funny because I also feel like, so is it just not going to be on the TV reruns landscape?
I don't think so. Forever. I mean, there's so much.
Literally forever?
Yeah. I mean, there's so much other stuff they can show now.
Yeah, that's true.
That they don't need to, and there's no demand for it, you know?
Yeah, they don't need to.
It's a very weird thing that way.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, that's a show I couldn't identify with because they were rich. Because they were black. You know?
I think it's just, for whatever reason, I just identified with shows that were less family oriented.
Yeah. Are you an only child or do you have siblings?
I have a brother, but he's 13 years older than me. We didn't live together for very long.
Right.
So I think there's something, I was always looking for older shows.
Right. Which is the thing, a shift that I've noticed culturally is that the shows that we have now are all aspirational. They're either all aspirational or they're essentially minstrel shows, poor minstrel shows where it's look at these poor people falling over and being dumb.
Yeah.
Or,
give me an example.
Honey Boo Boo.
Oh,
a show like that, we're just laughing at poor people.
Yeah.
Or they're, hey, we want to be rich. So they're aspirational. Yeah. Or a weird hybrid of the two where it's, we want to see rich people fail.
Yes.
Those seem to be the three categories. And we don't have any shows that are truly reflective of people's daily struggle or the normal angsty stuff like My So-Called Life. Or Roseanne is the one I always cite, which is a great blue-collar sitcom.
Yeah.
And the humor was very gallows humor and it seemed very real because they're just trying to get through their normal life by cracking jokes. I don't see anything like that now.
I think the other thing that's happened is if you want to have a really, really good 30-minute show, it's going to be a single camera show and it's going to be maybe more either comedically broad, 30 Rock or Arrested Development, which were really genius shows.
But very cartoonish.
Very cartoonish, but in a way that I loved, in a way that I aspire to. Or they're going to be very self-aware and hipsterish and indifferent.
Two Broke Girls or
Two Broke Girls. I don't even know where that is in the pantheon, but I would say I don't know, Togetherness or something.
Right, right, right.
These kind of shows that are not really comedies even.
Right.
And they're self-aware, and then they're self-aware about being self-aware.
They're
and
snarky.
Sort of,
there's not a sincerity there.
Yeah.
And I think, when one of the big things I like to do in this show is context is so important to me. And I think people will crap all over a lot of older shows or shows we grew up with, but I'm they were doing something sincere at least a lot of the time.
Yeah.
Even the very special episode, I'm those people thought they were kind of helping,
Yeah. And also, you needed to have that phase of television in order to have the current phase,
Yeah.
We look at things as being so hokey or something, but, they reflected a particular technical savvy that they had
True.
At that time. And they, it also comes down to editing capabilities on a television schedule.
Oh yeah,
you know what I mean.
Which
stuff like that.
I mean, you're doing a play, a three-camera sitcom was a play.
Like a show like Scrubs had, 25% more content.
Yeah.
Than a show All in the Family, just because editing.
Yeah.
And you
have more access to jokes and things that you can't do with a cutaway or a fantasy sequence that you couldn't do when you're really just writing dialogue.
Yeah.
So it's sort of a bit of a lost art. These people who wrote three-camera sitcoms that were great.
Yeah.
Like Barney Miller or, Cheers.
Yeah.
Or that stuff. There's very few shows like that because it's really hard to do.
It's really hard to do. And I've had a couple of things in the... something in the works and things in the past or whatever, and the idea of doing a multi-camera is just, I can't even imagine making it successful.
I mean, I've pitched multi-camera shows because I love them so much, and I think they're unfairly maligned.
What was your position on How I Met Your Mother?
I didn't like it very much because it was sort of, I didn't like Friends. And Friends to me started a whole subgenre of shows that I think How I Met Your Mother was the culmination of. And it just didn't connect. I didn't like the characters, but they felt falsely associated with each other.
Right.
Didn't seem natural.
Right.
Those shows that weren't built around a place, I feel like we lost those because like Cheers makes sense that those people yeah. would hang out because yeah. they're in that place
right,
workplace sitcoms like News Radio or Spin
News
City
Radio.
Or I mean those were just great three camera
yeah,
sitcoms
and
How I Met Your Mother just didn't, and I also found the Barney character just like way too snarky and hateful
and it
was one of those shows that I watched and I'm like, oh, I'm in a different generation now.
Well, I loved that show.
I know a lot of people that love it.
And it's funny because I almost loved it and then was embarrassed to admit that I loved it because
right.
so many people were like, oh, you know.
I don't think it's bad.
They,
it's not Big Bang Theory.
Really, but what they did, right, exactly. And it, but what also I think they did was that they took the multi-camera format and they decided to, like, play within it, like, you know, doing shows out of sequence
right.
and doing shows from different perspectives but the same story
right.
and doing, you know, a lot of that stuff.
Which
really
is stuff Friends did.
Not to the
not
extent.
Not to that extent.
No, How I Met Your Mother really, like, broke that open.
Did you ever see any of the three-camera UK shows, like Coupling?
Well, Coupling, I think, is the biggest precursor
yeah.
to How I Met Your
yeah,
Mother.
Because they did.
They did that all over the place, and I loved Coupling.
Yeah.
yeah.
And it makes perfect sense now when you see the guy who created Coupling moving on to Doctor Who, because some of those Coupling plots are incredibly complicated, technically.
Yes!
And it's like almost one-for-one kind of the
yes.
shows.
Yes, no, exactly. And I remember... being, you know, kind of starting comedy and seeing and getting like somehow downloading like Coupling episodes or
yep.
whatever. And I remember feeling like, oh, I could never write
right.
like that because this is so technically
that?
Just the time warping and all of the stuff and the what, you know, was so felt so complicated and remarkable, you
yeah.
know. But yeah, that's like for me something I aspire to do.
I mean, I think some of that is in comedy, especially we're seeing a huge influence of UK shows, which were not done by committee because of the way the system worked over there. They're kind of more auteur. You had stuff like Veep, which was a direct descendant of Armando Iannucci's stuff in the UK, and Coupling
yeah.
and stuff like Black Books and
yeah.
the IT Crowd, and those have sort of come back around to influence American sitcoms
yeah.
and shows in a good way.
Yeah, yeah. I agree, though. I still think American sitcom, American comedy is still the gold standard. For
yeah.
American television is still the gold standard.
Yeah, I mean, if you ask the creator of the IT Crowd, he'll tell you he's ripping off Seinfeld.
Right.
That show is no way like Seinfeld, but that's what happens.
Right,
like, you know, it's
right,
like
right,
bands.
Right.
It's like, we were just trying to sound like David Bowie.
Right,
and then
right,
they invented
right, right.
a, you know, thing that's totally different.
Yeah, exactly.
So when I asked you what time frame you were looking for, you said sort of late 80s, early 90s.
Yeah.
Assume that was when you're watching the most TV.
Yeah.
Probably like a tween
yeah.
before we had tweens.
Yeah, exactly.
And were you watching a lot of stuff with your parents? Were you watching it alone?
No, I was watching it alone. And my parents had two televisions.
Right.
And I was really intense about my television watching schedule.
Okay.
I was like, and I was also like a ridiculously good student. So I was like getting straight A's all the time.
Right.
And then, you know, and I timed everything so that I'd be done with my homework and blah, blah, blah. And I would, you know, so that I could get my primetime television and, or like, you know, tune into the odd, you know, I Love Lucy episode
right.
or something. And yeah, I mean, my parents were also, you know, for many years, they were working really hard and like weren't necessarily around.
Right.
And, so I feel like I was a bit of a, like, raised by television.
You're a latchkey kid?
Yeah.
Same here. Same here. It's not a bad thing.
It's not a bad... I mean,
yes.
I feel like I turned out okay.
Yeah.
So
oh, yeah.
I'm like, I did not
We can
have,
reclaim it.
We should... I didn't have
yeah.
the helicopter parents. I was just
yeah.
sort of generally obedient and, you know... and like,
if you're not doing anything wrong, like, why would they need
yeah,
to
like,
hover around
you? Yeah, like, it was
you?
Fine. And so... I know, it's funny, though. I really think, like, by the... You know, because... By the time I was like 8 or something, I was coming home alone and there'd be no one home, right?
Same, yeah.
And I don't think they would allow that anymore.
I don't think you can. I think that's not legal.
Yes!
I would walk home alone. I walked to school alone. I'd make myself
completely
food.
I was so alone a
yeah.
lot. And
yeah.
I don't think they would allow it. But that's, but I, and I would come home and I would turn on the TV and the TV was my best friend and loved television.
But it was sort of isolating, but it also made you much stronger as a person in a lot of ways because you're more independent. You can kind
yeah.
of, like, I know people who literally cannot be alone. Like, they're like, I can't just be alone with my
right,
thoughts.
Right, right,
it's like,
right.
It's, just, it's fine. It's going to be fine.
Well, I think in some way, I mean, I think it made me independent that, like, I could just figure shit out.
Right.
Like, if I needed to make a grilled cheese sandwich,
yeah.
like, I could do that. And I think the other, but I think what the television did was that I sort of, and now I'm a podcast junkie.
Yeah.
I feel like, I always needed to have something on in the background.
Yeah. Oh, me too. That was, and I've, my wife's kind of only just recently broken me of this, but as soon as I'd walk in the door, the TV would go on.
Yes.
I wouldn't even watch it. It would just be on.
Yes.
It was the first thing you did.
There's a, and it's a comforting sound.
Yeah.
And I, you know, I've been trying to, you know, break myself of that habit as well.
It's tough.
It is tough.
Thank God for sleep timers, because I go to bed every night with the television on. And that was like the best innovation in the world, because I don't wake up at 2 in the morning with the TV still on, which is always kind of like, what's happening?
Yeah. Oh, I've like tried to ban that practice like in the last couple
tough.
Of years.
In New York, I imagine it's very tough. You need that to drown out the sounds.
Yeah, I don't know. I'm okay with it, but it's more just like something anxiety. Like it, I think the reason I would have it on is that I'd be like, oh, I have all these things to do for tomorrow.
And you need the distraction.
Like, I needed like Letterman in the background saying some shit so that I couldn't think of anything.
Same. I mean, I think a lot of people, I mean, I as a kid, I slept maybe 2 hours and I had horrible insomnia, which was good. And then I watched all these amazing things I never would have exposed
great.
To. It was I'd recommend it for anyone. But I did get to see all kinds of things that I never would have seen, movies and comedy and stuff. But yeah, at the same time, the TV was that. It was like an easy white noise distraction so that you're not in your own head.
Yeah.
Which I think makes sense with a lot of people who are going to comedy, because you do tend to overanalyze everything.
Right.
So what did you go with on the Saturday night here?
So Saturday night, got the old TV guide, which is beautifully sepia toned.
Yes.
And I picked Golden Girls, which feels like, I think a lot of my choices are fairly obvious.
It's a good show, though.
But it was a good show. It was, there was something about it that felt a little naughty.
Yeah, there was a lot of sex jokes on it.
Yeah. And so I think as a kid, that felt exciting.
Yeah.
So that's why I went with Golden Girls for Saturday night.
This one is Blanche agonizes over an offer for the house that she can hardly refuse, but the prospect of partying recalls great times, including the parade of visiting relatives. This is a clip show, which was always sort of disappointing, but also sort of fun, because you didn't see reruns as much.
Yeah.
I always forgot that Blanche owned the house.
I forgot about clip shows.
Yeah. That's something we miss now.
And Blanche owned the house. Yeah. That's right. I don't know if I miss it. Clip shows are dumb.
Yeah, they sort of are. Well, I think they're not necessary now, because you can watch whatever you want whenever you want to watch
it.
Whereas then it was like, oh, I remember that. That's from 5 years ago.
Yeah, well, now you kind of, you need some, like, asshole online to do, like, a supercut of whatever. Blanche saying the same thing over and over again.
Horny Blanche supercut.
Yeah.
But I think it got weird a lot on that show, where if that was a show about 5 gay guys living in a house, which you could probably use the same scripts.
Oh, my gosh.
There would be no way in hell they would let
that on. And then, you know, when I went to college, like, you know, I had a gay roommate, shout out to Jeff, and
Jeff? Gay guy, Jeff?
I stopped from saying his last name, because I was like, oh, who probably doesn't want to be on a podcast? Yeah. But anyway, so he loved the Golden Girls.
Yeah.
And then would sort of kept that alive for me throughout college and stuff. So, yeah.
But that's, I mean, speaking of three-camera shows, that's a perfect show that was just funny on the page and had a great ensemble, and it was very pure, and
it didn't need bells and whistles.
Speaking of which, I'm watching Cops.
Small stories. That's the other thing. Like, I like the small plot line.
Yes. Yeah. There's not huge stakes. It's not the end of the world every time.
No.
Yeah. Although this one, they could lose the house. Cops,
I
still watch on Saturday nights to this day.
Shut up.
When it originally started, it was actually kind of an interesting documentary series, and they would follow the people through booking and, like, rehab.
And it was raw. It felt raw.
Very raw, Now they literally have specials where they're like, they have a Christmas special called Ho Ho Ho's that's just prostitutes.
Oh, I want to kill myself.
Like, that's what Cops has become. And I'm like, at first it was
an
interesting show.
They TLC'd
it. Yeah. Oh, yeah. They have a taser special. That's
great.
Yeah. But that show also makes me feel better about my place in humanity. Watch it still every Saturday. did you go with anything else on Saturday night there?
No. I only picked a one thing for Saturday.
That's fine.
I think Saturday night was the last. I would also obviously watch SNL.
Yes. Every Saturday night. 92.
I'm going to watch it like every. I was one of those kids that wasn't like obsessed. A lot of my friends were.
I was,
And I don't know. I think, you know, we also, like, our glamorous Saturday nights involved, like, a sleepover where we would rent a movie.
Yep.
And so, you know, I remember doing a lot of that, renting movies.
Like renting My Girl? That seems like a sleepover movie.
Yeah, exactly. Just
maybe Adventures in
like
Babysitting
that.
Or something.
Totally.
Saturday night, when was the first time you went to New York? How old were you?
I was in high school. We just came here for the day because I was in a really nerdy summer camp at Yale.
Oh, nice. Okay.
For debate.
Okay.
And they brought us to New York City for the day.
Because I know, like, I, you know, obviously New York's not that far from Boston, but Saturday Night Live and, like, MTV's House of Style, those really, like, in the first season of The Real World, I was like, wow, New York's pretty cool.
Yes.
Like, just based on those things, those
yes.
really shaped my vision of New York. Because before that, it was all Night Court.
MTV's Real World, like, first season.
It was in, I think, on the Bowery area. It was a loft.
No, I mean, what year was it?
Oh, 1991.
1991.
Yeah, that was the first season.
Yeah, yeah.
And even that
yeah.
was an
that
interesting
also
documentary.
Felt titillating. Because
yeah.
it felt like you were watching young adults. Or they weren't even that young, but they were like in their, some of them
late
were in their 20s,
30s. 30s, yeah.
But you felt like they were, like, you could have that life.
Oh, yeah.
And so
yeah.
it was exciting. And also, it was like, I remember, like, I really, like, you know, my parents didn't, we didn't have cable. And then we did. And it was like,
yeah.
you know what I mean?
It's a whole new world, everybody.
Totally,
yeah.
totally.
I mean, that show, even the first season, wasn't aspirational. It was like people struggling to do art and to be a writer and a musician and a
yeah,
dancer.
They were
and
like
it was
had
interesting.
Real,
yeah.
literally real world, real lives. They didn't engineer the show.
Right.
They were really looking at it like, let's put up some cameras on.
See what happens.
And see what happens. And so, and I actually think, you know, and maybe it was more labor intensive that way because it
you gotta
puts
find
a lot
story.
More. You have to find a story.
yeah.
And as someone who's made now 3 feature documentaries, it's extraordinarily difficult.
Yeah.
But the content is so much more rewarding once
yeah.
it's done. The show is just absolutely more riveting.
Yeah.
And then the minute where it feels like a producer is pulling the strings, that's when you're like, I don't, you know,
I
know it and I don't enjoy it.
The first season, one of the women started dating one of the producers
yes.
and they fired the producer.
Yes.
And that was like, you can't do, you've crossed the line in a documentary.
The line. Yeah.
And it's just amazing to see how far they've or how low they've come
Completely.
Since then.
Completely.
But people forget The Real World was the show that invented reality TV.
Yeah.
There
yeah.
were some things before that, but that was the show
that
invented
show.
Reality TV as we know it.
Yeah.
It was it really was.
Yeah.
Which is and I love that first season. Sunday night, what'd you go with?
Sunday
Tough
night.
Tough night. Always a hard night.
I went with, well, you know, I'll be honest, I used to Sunday nights be very open to the Sunday night movie.
It was always a big deal on Sunday nights because in the pre-cable days, they would
yeah,
do a premiere movie.
They would do a premiere movie, and I feel like my parents were also into it, and, you know, just as a family, we were into it. But I think by 1989... I was probably, you know, I definitely remember watching the Tracy Ulman show. I did not,
yes.
I don't remember watching the Gary Shandling show. And it maybe would have been a little above my head at
it
that
It was
age.
A weird show. That was the fourth wall breaking show. It was very knowing and was, that was one of the shows that taught me about sitcom form and
yeah.
also rewarded me for watching years of sitcoms.
Yeah, like I watched Gary Shandling episodes like, much later.
Yeah.
And in a way that, and I was like, and I remember like, holy cow, this was made in the 80s and
yeah,
90s.
Because
like,
Comedy Central re-aired them later, I think.
Yeah,
in the late
I think that's what it was. But I think at that age, I wouldn't have understood it. And Tracy Ullman was, she did like a sketch show.
Yep.
And she did a million different characters. And that was just so easy to chew up as a kid.
Oh, absolutely.
You know, like you really didn't have to do much thinking.
And The Simpsons was born out of that. And some of the sketches weren't comedy sketches. They were dramatic.
Right.
Which was really weird.
Yeah.
And she did that teenage girl character, Francesca. That was,
God,
I loved that
an
character.
Amazing memory.
It's,
I
don't
all.
Utilize it all. She was the one with the braces. She had 2 dads. And it would mostly be her kind of doing monologues in
yeah.
her bedroom. And
yeah.
they were, you know, it was a thing you never saw anymore. Do you have anything else on Sunday night?
That's all I put down.
I did not watch Married with Children, a show I cannot watch to this day. Was there anything your parents didn't allow you to watch? Like, was there anything forbidden?
So I think the late 80s was also Dynasty, right?
Dynasty was just ending. And actually, on the cover of this issue is Tracy Scoggins from Dynasty.
From Dynasty.
Says the truth about Tracy Scoggins, why she's so hard to figure. I don't know exactly what that means. But yeah, it was... You were sort of seeing the transition where these huge 80s shows were transitioning to the 90s and starting to drop off.
Right. And then morph into stuff like Beverly Hills 90210.
Right. Melrose Place.
Melrose Place. So I remember really wanting to watch, but I was a kid.
Yeah.
I mean, I had no place.
Yeah.
But
Falcon
I
Crest.
Really wanted to watch the Dynasty.
Did your parents watch it?
I think my mom maybe checked it out. But you know, my parents were never like big TV people.
Right.
You know, I remember that we watched Peter Jennings.
Okay. So you'd watch ABC the news together.
We would watch the news together. And I, you know, I'd be like grumpy about it.
Right. I would say the news was essentially punishment for kids. Like you could threaten children with the news.
Yeah.
Like, put the news on.
Like, and here's the dorkiest thing about me. That experience of like watching that show every night and feeling like getting like a capper on what happened in America that day is something that has carried over through to IDVR, the nightly news.
The network nightly news.
The network, like a weird grandmother.
Yeah,
IDVR, the network nightly news. And I like the roundup feeling to it. I like it's like for me, it's like they've sifted through all the shit and then they're going to tell me like four things, you know? And when you don't have time to check your 47 different news apps.
Yeah.
Or
24-hour news channels just talking about nothing.
Oh, I can't. You know, that's what it is. I used to watch so much 24-hour news.
Yeah.
And then at a certain point, I realized it was actually making me an angry person.
Oh, yeah, because it's the exact opposite of what news should do. You have newscasters theorizing on what's happening. Like, we may see him come out of the house. He might be a demon. Like, they just, because they have to talk.
He might be a demon.
Yeah, like, it's always, because they're usually not the brightest people, depending on what the station is. And so they, like, you're putting someone who can't really improv and doesn't have a lot of information to just not ever stop talking. It's a really weird thing to do. Whereas the formality of the networks.
They should have improvisers.
They really should.
That would make a lot more sense.
Oh, they'd make it way more entertaining and probably more informative.
They would just like, yes, and the news.
Yes. And so you are the murderer. Well, no. No, you have to say yes. It's don't negate what I've said. But the formal nightly news, it's kind of, I like how old-fashioned it is.
Yes.
It's vetted. People
it's
kind
produced.
Of produced it. Yes.
Yes.
And I like that. People are like, well, it shouldn't have a point. I'm like, it's news. It has a point of view. It has a point to a story. It has an angle. That's what news is.
Yeah. It feels clean. I like it.
Yeah. No, I agree with you. We're not alone there. We're latchkey kids who like the nightly news. Monday night, what'd you go with?
Monday night. I put down two things. One, motorcycling : Robbie Knievel.
Yes, Evel Knievel's son.
So first, and I wrote this down because it just seems like something we wouldn't have now.
No.
And there was like a period in our nation's history where we were like duly, you know, obsessed with motorcycling challenges or something.
Oh, yeah, stunts. The 70s was all about CB radios and stunts and motorcycles. I think it was the baby boomer generation looked at motorcycles like freedom.
Oh.
And so they used to really like to watch that stuff in the 70s. And I always feel bad for Robbie Knievel because I know people who've had to go into their family business, and when your dad's family business is breaking all his bones, you'd be like, I don't want to jump over the trucks, Dad.
Did Evel Knievel die in the course of being,
you know, I don't
doing
think he
thing.
Did. I know he got hurt like real bad a lot.
Right?
Because that was the thing. He wasn't really actually that good at it.
Right, because he damaged himself.
He would
so
get
much.
Hurt every single time.
Yeah.
But yeah, Robbie
so
Knievel,
Robbie
poor
Knievel.
Guy.
And I, yeah, because I wrote it, I was like, I didn't even know that his son did that.
Didn't last long.
And B, it just seems like such a throwback type of show.
Oh yeah, this was old at this point. It was it was very
old. It was
old, at this
old
point.
For like 1989.
Big
if
time.
It feels out of place.
And you know what it was? You know what they counter-programmed it with? Circus highlights. I cannot imagine circus highlights on the television at any point in the 21st century.
Well, and then. Yeah. No, and those were the kind of, as a kid, I would have just completely breezed past those things.
Yeah.
Like, those things just would not have captured my interest. But you know what did? Because, again, I was an adult child. Murphy Brown.
Yeah, Murphy Brown.
Murphy
and again,
Brown.
Especially if you're into the news.
Oh, I loved, and I didn't know this. It's not like I was self-aware about it, but I think I loved seeing a lady be in charge of some shit.
Oh, yeah. And she did not take any, like, she was not a,
oh, she was so funny.
As much as I love Mary Tyler Moore show, that show is so about her being not a victim, but kind of being like, I don't know what's going on.
Yeah, like there's like a cutesy element. And Murphy Brown was not cutesy.
No, she was 100% in charge of everybody on that show.
Yes, sarcastic and ridiculous.
And such it was a weird role for her, too, because I knew her from watching SNL reruns, and she was like a beautiful, funny.
On SNL?
She hosted it like every season.
Oh, gotcha.
Because her father was Edgar Bergen, who's a famous ventriloquist. So as a kid, she was on stuff like You Bet Your Life with Groucho Marx ton of stuff. So she's like from a showbiz dynasty family.
Right, right, right.
But it was amazing to see her be funny and just great on that show.
Yeah.
I was
she was great.
Diehard CBS Monday night person, speaking of being older than your physical body. Every Monday night CBS. Murphy Brown, Designing Women, Newhart, Kate and Allie, that's 2 hours of like pure delight for me.
That's hilarious.
And I still will revisit those shows.
I remember also like watching Designing Women now and again. I don't think I was like, you know.
It holds up. Anything else on Monday night yet there?
That was it.
Tuesday night. What'd
Tuesday
you go
night. With? I just have Roseanne, and I noticed on the schedule that Roseanne was on multiple networks at the same time.
Yes.
Which I didn't realize that happened. But Roseanne was... when did that start?
It started in 88 as a mid-season replacement.
So this is like early in its career.
Yes, it's just, but it was such an unusual, like it stood out immediately.
Right.
The tone was so much
it
different.
It stood out immediately. It was so funny. And I think it's also one of those shows that also kind of holds up. I mean.
Big time.
It you know, you watch, like it's, I don't know. And John Goodman and Roseanne Barr, I mean. Everyone was really, it was perfectly cast.
Oh, yeah. They look like real people. They talked like people I knew. Their struggles seemed similar. If you look at everyone who kind of runs comedy now, they all started on Roseanne. Joss Whedon started on Roseanne. Judd Apatow started on Roseanne. Chuck Lorre started on Roseanne. Like, so for all the different, very different paths of the people who basically run television comedy now, they all went through Roseanne.
And it's funny because there's like a, you know, it's this white working class family, and the aesthetic of the show was very like drilled down to like its perfect style, because there was what those knit blank crochet
that afghan on the
on the thing
couch.
And I remember like I had one, you know, my best friend, her family was like, you know, this kind of like middle class white family. And I would go to her house and there was always one of those things draped over the couch.
Yeah.
And I just always felt like that's what it is to be a white family.
That's
you
what you
have
get.
A
you get a knitted thing.
Couch.
Yeah. Why is it on the couch? Isn't the couch good enough? Yeah. That's what I love. It was not aspirational. They didn't live in a mansion loft in New York.
No.
But it also wasn't like, look at them. They live in a dirt hole. They're
and
pigs.
And then my dad had a colleague that knitted for my parents for Christmas one of those things.
You're like, we made it.
And I was like, I was obsessed. It was purple, and I was obsessed with this knitted thing. And and I think part of it was just because I loved it on Roseanne. I loved it at my friend's house. It was just like this thing that I loved.
Yeah. We have it now. Where is it now?
It's in Palm Springs.
You're like, it's like, you guys, you
didn't
still
let my,
want
my
that?
Mom want to throw it out. I was like, you're not throwing it out.
Send that
Come
to
on.
Me.
Yeah.
People come over and be like, you made it. I think now that you have a book out, you deserve the knitted thing.
I didn't deserve the knitted thing.
I definitely would have watched that. I'm also intrigued by a made-for-TV movie starring Raquel Welch called Trouble in Paradise. Getting shipwrecked with her was like a dream come true. That's what a rough and tough sailor thought for the first 5 minutes.
Isn't that the premise of... also that Brooke Shields movie?
Oh, Blue Lagoon?
Yeah.
No, that is a lot weirder. That is children who are basically orphaned in a wreck.
She's like a teenager?
They get wrecked on the island as children, but grow into teenagers. And they're the only two people they know. Oh, what a creepy movie.
Bone.
Yeah.
They bone?
Oh, yeah. There's a lot of boning. Gotcha. There's a lot of nudity. And then they made a sequel called Return to Blue Lagoon with Mila Jovovich in it in like 91.
Really?
Yeah. Yeah. They were like, we don't have enough underage teenage girl island movies. Let's bring that back. That's a good idea. Yeah. It's a creepy, creepy movie. Very creepy
That's
movie.
Really weird.
But they really try to present it, be like, it's the pure innocence of love. It's fine. They're like, nah.
No,
it's not
gross.
Fine.
It's
gross. Wednesday night, what'd you get?
Wednesday
with?
Night, I wrote down, I think a fairly obvious one is Growing Pains. Watch.
I love Growing Pains. And this is maybe my favorite season of Growing Pains.
And what season was it? This
is season 3.
Okay.
Season 2 and 3 are my favorites. That's when Just the 10 of Us spun off, which is my favorite spinoff series of all time.
Okay.
Then the show started getting a little bad when Kirk Cameron got super Christian.
Yeah, when was that?
That was season 4 when Chelsea Noble came on.
This is like right before that happened.
Yeah.
I saw him recently talking about, I think, Donald Trump or something.
Yeah, and, he's great.
And it was weird.
Yeah. Bananas prove that God exists.
Yeah.
This is Maggie's magic moment interrupts Ben's birthday celebration for a trip to the hospital where Ben confesses to a friendly patient that he's allegedly feeling crowded by the new baby. So Mrs. Seaver's pregnant, yeah. Season 3. She has Chrissy, baby season 4, 8-year-old season 5. There's lost years of growing pains. But a fun show that was fairly smart and did a lot of weird sort of meta comedy. And I really enjoyed that show.
I think I also just really love the timbre of Alec.
Alan Thicke.
Alan Thicke's voice. Yep. Yeah. There was just something about his voice that I thought he was a really singer. Remarkable.
He wrote the theme to Facts of Life and Different Strokes. Yes, and wrote and sang the theme to his children's game show, Animal Crackups.
Oh, my God.
His son is Robin Thicke, the singer.
Right. Yeah. No, it makes sense now. Yeah. I didn't know that he had this, like, musical. Okay, oh, yeah. This is crazy.
I would have watched that. It is a repeat.
I also put down here Cagney and Lacey, not because I watched it at the time, but I think that I should have watched it at the time.
It's
like
worth checking out.
Ladies in Charge. Like yeah. This kind of Ladies in Charge thing that I like.
Oh, yeah. They were kicking ass in that show. And it was very popular.
Yeah. And they also struck me as, like, normal ladies. They weren't, like, beauty queen ladies. Because now when you see ladies in a cop show.
It's Pam Anderson.
They're so hot.
Yeah,
you know?
That's not.
And it feels ridiculous. Yes. Not that cops can't be hot.
Just not all of
just
them.
Just that, like, yeah.
Yeah.
So anyway, I think that I liked it for that.
That is a good show. It's worth
liked it.
Revisiting.
I should have liked it. Yeah.
You could still like it.
You know what? It's over for me.
No, it's over. It's past. I'm watching a special Candid Camera special, Candid Camera on Wheels, which has special appearances by Pia Zadora, Geraldo Rivera, Edie McClurg, and Elliot Gould. Just sounds crazy.
Geraldo Rivera is still in the biz.
Yep. Geraldo Rivera plays.
He's got abs.
Oh, yeah. Pia Zadora plays a woman with a faulty explanation of no fault insurance. I like a hidden camera show with Pia Zadora and Geraldo Rivera. I may have also watched Unsolved Mysteries, which always terrified me.
Oh, my God.
Anything else on Wednesday that you had?
That was it.
Thursday night, what'd you have?
Thursday night, I wrote Cosby, which again, like I said before, is something I may or may not have watched.
Yeah.
And I wrote Cheers and Dear John. And I think, I watched Cheers.
Yep.
When did that end?
Cheers ended in 92.
Okay.
It was a big deal here.
Yeah.
As you would imagine.
Oh, that's right.
Yeah.
Yeah, Boston. So, I remember feeling that there was that was another one of those titillating show categories because they were in a bar.
Yeah, it was very adult.
Right, and like in a bar also not only felt like something that I had never walked into as a kid, but something that I felt like my parents had never walked into.
But that's the exact opposite of my experience as a kid because I was often babysat by my uncle at a bar. But so in that respect, it was kind of like, oh yeah, I know these guys that hang out at a bar. But this sounds weird, but I had never thought of watching the show that way where it seemed like a sort of a forbidden place you didn't really get to go in.
Yeah,
it's like a teacher's lounge.
I think half the shows I watched had a forbidden quality. I mean, it's not like it was porn. You know
no,
what I mean?
But
like
it's still an adult
place.
But
there place. Was an adult, yeah, there was like an adultness to it that felt like, ooh.
That makes sense. See, I felt like it was comforting because I'm like, oh, yeah,
I
know these guys.
No, I
but it would be interesting seeing that. Yeah.
All of that whole scene in it was, you know, and I think the other thing is like when you're talking about a kid who's growing up in Palm Springs, California, which is in the desert, which is, I lived among senior citizens.
Yeah, I was going to say that's basically, all I think is Bob Hope and retired people.
I lived among senior citizens or gay senior citizens.
Okay.
And, I was a lone kid in the neighborhood, and like I would be playing on the in the front yard, and there would just be very, very slow moving Cadillacs like rolling down the street at minimum speed.
We're going to the tiki bar.
Yeah, and so
except not a Boston accent.
Nothing in Palm Springs looked like Cheers.
Right.
And so I think a lot of these shows for me just felt otherworldly. They did
Does
not
that
feel
urban grit kind of thing.
The grit, yeah. They didn't, and my life just didn't look like that at all whatsoever.
And is that where you were like New York?
I think so.
Yeah.
I think that's what happened because I also just I remember saying, you know, that like Palm Springs was the cultural armpit of America, and I think a lot of kids feel that way.
Yeah.
About their hometown, but Palm Springs, but Southern California in general, it's not old. It's not, you know, right. It's not been around for very long. It doesn't have the gravitas that the Northeast has.
We're Northeast literally sitting on stairs older than Palm Springs right now.
Yeah. Because we're sitting in Harvard Yard. Did we mention that at the time?
We are in Harvard Yard. Yes.
And it's old as balls. Yeah. And like, I wanted to be around stuff that was old.
Right.
And Cheers felt like, it felt like that, you know, the bar was, you know, the mahogany wood, you know, the art design made you feel like you were in Boston.
And that bar,
though you were in Los Angeles,
really looks like that.
Oh, really?
They when they made that show, they went into the Bull and Finch pub and they bought the layout. And you go in there and it literally looks exactly like that. And it's, you know, I sort of take for granted talking to you, realizing how different that would be for a lot of people. Because that was the show where I was like, oh, this is a show with real people in it. Oh, this is one of those shows that's like a real show.
No, for me, it was a show with otherworldly people in it.
Right. And I would watch stuff in Palm Springs and be like, ooh, golf courses and flamingos. Very exciting. Oh, totally. Yeah, so that must-see TV night was The Block. I mean, everyone had to watch that. Yeah. I liked Dear John, even though it was a very depressing show.
Well, I remembered the theme song was like, Dear John, life goes on. By the time you read this letter, I'll be gone.
Yeah, depressing. A remake of a British show.
Oh, really?
Yeah, a much more depressing British show, as was Who's the Boss?
Oh, my God.
But, yeah, that's how Judd Hirsch and his post-Taxi show. It was about a group of single, sad people who had a support group. And I think the group was called the One-to-Oners.
I don't remember any of this. Yeah. This is so funny.
That's what the show. It took place in this classroom, like an adult education classroom, where they just sat around and talked
about
being single.
In my mind, I had him being a teacher. He wasn't a teacher.
No, he has a teacher.
It was just that they were in a room.
They were in a school room, yeah.
Oh, got you.
And they were always talking about just how sad and lonely they all were every week.
Yeah. I think I maybe mostly watched it for the theme song.
It was a good theme song, yeah.
I'll think about theme song like once
life
every 6
goes
months.
On.
Yeah.
Dear John. Yeah, I'm into that. Although I am sort of intrigued by the 2-hour sizzling season finale of Knots Landing, where Paige has been sticking her pretty little nose into dangerous places. I mean, I'm intrigued by that. I'm going to watch that. Friday night, the final night of the week.
I think Friday night is also a tough night for television because I remember, what was the show, Family Matters?
The TGIF,
That kind of stuff turned me off.
I did not like Family Matters
at all.
No,
I did not like it. Again, I was a child, old person.
Yeah.
And so those things felt childish to me.
It was stupid. You're like, this is dumb.
Exactly.
Yeah.
So I had a hard time choosing from Friday night. I put down Columbo and Perfect Strangers.
Okay.
And Perfect Strangers, too, even at the time, I was like, I think this is a poor, like, stereotyping of this character, Balky.
Even though it's
like,
a fictional country.
Even though it's a fictional, and even though I don't know what I'm talking about, like, ideologically, there's something about this that feels ridiculous.
I don't think you're wrong there,
yeah.
It was a Laugh at the Immigrant show, which we had a lot of. Like, Yakov Smirnoff, who was huge, he had a show called What a Country, where the premise was basically Dear John, but in an English as a second language class. And it was literally like, they don't know anything. And people loved it for like the 3 weeks
that
it was
hilarious.
On. I think I would have gone with Beauty and the Beast with Ron Perlman and Linda Hamilton, which I don't know if you remember that show.
No.
This was a huge show for about 2 years. And it was a show where CBS realized that they could get young women to watch.
Uh-huh.
And it was literally Ron Perlman. There's a picture of him as the Beast.
Yeah, he's ugly.
Plays an ugly cat man.
You know, they have a mask on him to make him ugly.
He's no makeup. He's living in the sewers and has a relationship with post-Terminator Linda Hamilton. It's about this forbidden world, kind of vaguely sci-fi.
And then, was this based on a Broadway show? Or
no,
nothing?
No. It was sort of based on the official
book?
I think it's an old fairy tale.
And then like many, many years later, Ashton Kutcher would then executive produce the show Beauty and the Geek.
Right, which was somewhat similar in that they all had to date Ron Perlman. That was every episode, everyone wanted a date with Ron Perlman. This is Vincent's dark side looms even closer when he hears a version of the story of his birth, and even Catherine can't seem to ease his suffering. I do also like that Richard Roundtree, Shaft himself, has a guest starring role in this episode as Cleon Manning.
That's impressive.
Yeah.
That's impressive.
That was a show I watched. I didn't like it. It was very soap opery, but for some reason I was like, let's get a monster.
Yeah.
I like monsters. So that brings us to the end of the week.
End of the week.
Is there anything that you watch now? Is there anything that you like can't miss that's not news or anything narrative that you absolutely have to watch?
there's so, I feel like there's so many things that I absolutely have to watch, but I'm like backed up. I mean, like Game of Thrones.
I've never seen it.
Well, you know, you
it's on my list though. It's on my list of like I need
know,
to watch
just,
this.
There's so many things that that can be on your list. There's a show the show called Catastrophe on Amazon.
Yes, yep, with Rob Delaney.
Rob Delaney.
Boston's own Rob Delaney.
I think it's a wonderful show.
Yeah, I love Sharon Horgan. She's very funny.
She's very funny. I like the pace of the show. It's really fast.
Are there any comfort shows you watch from when you're a kid that you'll put on for you know when you walk in the door kind of thing?
No, but you know what comfort shows I do put on like shows that I that I have followed sort of for many years that maybe a lot of people have not followed as long as I have, and I'll put it on to like tune out is Grey's Anatomy.
I can't believe it's still on.
I know. It's remarkable
it's
that it's
for
still
like
on.
15 years.
She's a widow now.
Yeah. Oh
I
my.
Mean.
She's 71 years old. She's a TV widow. She's 34.
I know, exactly. Like Scandal. I think a lot of the Shonda Rhimes stuff has this kind of like calming quality.
Well, the procedural stuff is pretty common because you kind of know
it's
going to follow
a
formula.
It's going to follow a certain formula, and then you're going to get like a, you know, a B or C plot that's like follows one of their love lives, you know, and that's nice.
Like Bones.
Yeah, I don't want to. Yeah, I don't want to. You know, like I wasn't ever a Law and Order type person, but I like those things for a good, you know, and here's another show that I'm actually extremely excited to get back into. I think it's starting very soon this week or something. A show called Unreal.
Okay.
The first season was, and it's a show, I think it's on Lifetime, and it, which is remarkable because you don't think of Lifetime as having kind of
just
any
movies.
Like, right, and they made this show. It's remarkable, and it's about reality TV, but in a way that's like so, it's gritty, but and it has a little bit of a soap opera element to it, but just really captivating.
I think on some of those fringier networks, we get some under the radar stuff.
Yeah,
that
like and less under the radar, but also on a surprising network, Mr. Robot. You know, on the USA Network is like phenomenal.
Yeah, well, I loved Burn Notice. that was a show that I watched every week on USA Network. But yeah, Mr. Robot, great, and Christian Slater. I mean, come on.
I know. Yeah. I mean, it's great.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Cool. Well, thank you so much for doing this.
Thank you so much for having me. This has been really fun, and your knowledge of television is extraordinarily impressive.
I'm very sorry that you had to be impressed by it.
Thank you. Oh, baby, I see you in my teenage age, yeah, baby.
There you go. That's Negin. As I said, she has a very good book out, How to Make White People Laugh. You will want to purchase it, and you should purchase it wherever fine books are sold. You can also watch any of her movies or check out her stand-up, or definitely go see her live if she comes to your town. Or if she comes to her town. I almost said her town. If she comes to her town, you should go too. But it might cost you more depending on where you live. So as always, we have brand new episodes each and every Wednesday here on the show. We also often have bonus episodes unannounced on other days, so be sure to subscribe to the show so you do not miss them. If you like the show, which I presume you do if you got this far into the episode, please rate and review the show on iTunes or wherever you listen. It's a huge help. It helps people hear about the show. I make no money on the show. I just want many people to hear about it because I'm very proud of the show. So we'll see you again next time on Wednesday for a brand new edition of TV Guidance Counselor.
Hostile soil. Yeah. I don't give a fuck. They're naked and they're fighting. Yeah. If I needed to make a grilled cheese sandwich, like I could do that. I was obsessed. It was purple and I was obsessed.